with proud thanksgiving as mother for her children, England mourns for her dead across the sea. Flesh of her flesh they were, spirit of her spirit, fallen in the cause of the free. Solemn the drums thrill, death august, royal, sing sorrow up into immortal spheres. There is music in the midst of desolation and a glory that shines upon our tears. They went with song to the battle, they were young, straight of limb, true of eye, steady in the glow. They were staunch to the end against odds uncounted. They fell with their faces to the foe. They mingle not with their laughing comrades again. They sit no more at familiar tables at home. They have no lot in our labour of the daytime. They sleep beyond England's foam. But where our desires are and our hopes profound, felt as a wellspring that is hidden from sight, to the innermost heart of their own land, they are known as the stars are known to the night. As the stars that shall be bright when we are dust, moving in marches upon the heavenly plains, as the stars that are starry in the time of our darkness, to the end, they remain. For they shall grow not old, as we that left them old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn, and at the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them. Lest we forget. Good afternoon, folks, and welcome to the Last ANZAC. A special tribute, a country music tribute to the Diggers. That poem I just read for you, of course, somebody will recognise, many of you will recognise the last verse. The RSL have taken poetic licence. The RSL took poetic licence there and pinched the last verse out of Lawrence Binion's poem, To the Fallen. And that was the whole lot of it, and I think it's a startling, a wonderful poem. Written in 1923. Hi folks, welcome to the Last ANZAC, the Spirit of a Nation, a country music tribute to the legend of the nigger. I'd like to introduce my White Rose Orchestra for this year. On piano, Gary Steele. On guitar, Guy Duncan. He's single too, girls. On the big bass guitar, Giles Smith. You were hired, you bugger. Derek Jackman. And I'll introduce you another guy in a minute. I grew up to respect the traditions of ANZAC Day, folks. It is a source of pride in Australia. In fact, I've always thought of ANZAC Day as the real Australia Day. And for that reason, when the last man to face the Turks at the first landing recently passed away, a little bit of me seemed to pass away as well. The Gallipoli campaign is popularly seen as the birthplace of Australian nationhood and of the ANZAC legend. It extended from the departure of the first convoy of Australians and New Zealanders to the Middle East for training in November 1914, through to the evacuation in December 1915. The campaign was intended to force Turkey out of the First World War. The aims of the campaign and the parts played by the ANZACs were well documented, especially after the first dawn landing at ANZAC Cove on the 25th of April, 1915. So, I suppose it might seem strange to start this personal tribute to the lads in the present day. But in 1919, a group of First World War veterans revisited the Gallipoli Peninsula 75 years after the young ANZACs had jumped from the landing barges into history. My initial thought motivated me to do this show. You see, I just couldn't imagine what it must have been like to visit the graves of your long dead mates, where once you had stood side by side, facing an unknown enemy. Now you stand as a frail old man. An old friend, here I am, told you I'd be back. As usual, mate, I'm bloody late, 75 years down the track. For the last time, here I stand, in this familiar foreign land, back with the mates I left behind. behind, forever in their time. And of all the blokes, of all the boys who haunt this lonely place, only one of them wears a cheery grin, your Queensland joker's face. When I drown in all the bloody dreams, the helpless young man's dying screams, feel your arm in my hand a shake, and your voice say, steady mate. The country that you died for, mate, well, you wouldn't know it now. The future that we dreamed about got all twisted up somehow. The peace that we were fighting for, the end to stupid, senseless war, so it couldn't happen to our kids. Well, old mate, it did. But thank you for the gift of years and the flame that brightly burns. Lessons taught, all the lessons taught, often wasted and unlearned. Lest we forget, cry the multitude, as if I ever could. So forgive an old man's tears, thank you for the years.
Soldier boys today, for don't you think they've done it grand along the Castlereagh?
to every mother's son their parts like men they'll play. They came from Western Farm and Run and from the Castle Ray. During the time our ANZACs were training in Egypt, the newspapers at the time kicked up a lot of fuss about our lads having the peculiar habit of stripping off all their uniforms because of the heat. One such article referred to our Aussie boys as
the Naked Army.
Let me read it for you. English newspaper.
Not since the prehistoric Stone Age has such a naked army been seen in civilised warfare as the Australian Army Corps fighting on the Gallipoli Peninsula. These suntanned, stalwart, athletic colonels display an utter abhorrence for superfluous clothing. They are famous throughout Europe for their hard fighting, their hard swearing and nakedness, even to the point of indecency. In marked contrast is our British regular, who never discards clothing under what circumstances they're fighting. Another perspective on this comes from signaller Tom Scahill, who wrote, he was one of the boys over on the first landing barges, and he wrote this verse on the 25th of August 1915 after reading that particular article. I reckon anyway. We ain't no picture postcards, nor studies in black and white. We don't go up in evening clothes and we go out and fight. We've forgotten all our manners, and our talk is full of slang. We ain't got no time for grammar when you hear the rifles bang. The heat here and the vermin nearly drove us barmy, so we peeled off all our clopper and we're called the Naked Army. We never wear our tunics unless it's cold at night, and socks and shirts and panties, we've chucked them out of sight. We only wear a pair of shorts that don't near reach our knees. We're burnt as brown as berries. Soon, still, we'd sooner sun than fleas. But the Tommies fighting around us think we've got a bally rat. They're all tucked up to the bottom and us in shorts and hat. The air and the sun don't hurt us in this land of fleas and strife. So we've chucked away our clobber and prefer the simple life. The rookie, when first landed, hangs on to all his clothes. But when the greybacks bite him, it's off to the beach he goes. Then off comes shirt, tunic, boots, socks and page too. He dives deep in the briny. But where's what others do? If our girls can only see us now, just as we're fighting here, I wonder if they'd hug us, smile and kiss and call us dear. Sure thing, they still would love us. Although we're burnt and lean, they'd think of our homecoming and go off and buy a sewing machine. Still, clothes don't make the fighter, nor speech don't show the man, but conduct in the trenches proves out the fighting man. This ain't no bloomin' picnic, the earth hides heaps of slain. We'll fight on to avenge him, or he won't come home again. We were the first at landing, and we're hanging on until the Turks get all that's coming. Then we'll be in at the kill. When we march through old Connie, some Tom will yell, "Lord blimey, there lies the old Turks here, and double up, it's the Naked Army." I'd like to introduce to you right now, folks, my musical compadre here, another local boy here in Tamworth, as I am, Mr. Randall Wilson on the percussion. I just like to show you something here, folks, that you might find interesting. During my research for the show, I had many people send me lots and lots and lots and lots of stuff, and I can't fit it all in the show, but some of them were just so moving that I have to relate to some of my memories of this to you. This one woman in Queensland, she sent me this stuff. I just can't tell you the sorrow that was expressed in these letters here, because they're actually letters from a young lad at Gallipoli, I believe it was either her
brother or a father, I'm not really sure because I couldn't work it out from the letters, and I apologise for that. But what it must have been like to receive letter after letter. January 19th, 1916. Mum, wish I was home. Jeez. And then of course at the end of it all, it's something that just broke into tears, folks. It was the letter that every mother hates to get, I suppose, during war. Dear Mr. and Mrs. Grant, House of Representatives, being up there. Dear Mr. and Mrs. Grant, our deepest sympathies with the reported death of your son, a gallant soldier, 19th of the 6th, 1917. He'd only written the letter the day before. She received it 2 weeks after she got this. During August this year, we'll see the centenary of the Australian Army Nursing Service of New South Wales. 13 nurses from this group saw action in the Boer War. 2,000 Australian nurses served abroad in every major theatre of conflict in the 1418 War. At Gallipoli, nurses served in hospital ships off the coast and in primitive hospitals in Lemnos. They were in France until the end of hostilities and continued to minister to men in hospitals and on troop ships back in Australia. When I was at the RSL Club the other night, who went to the opera? Who went to the RSL Opera? I'm sorry, I got a bit carried away, didn't I? Well, they asked me to come, Phoebe. Not my fault, they were bloody upstage. Now, didn't they have the books? Now, well, Dave said the stage is yours. It's the wrong thing to say to me, like I don't know. This woman, Thelma, she came up to me after my opera performance the other night, smacked me across the ear. I know she did. She came up to me, old woman Thelma, I think she's about 80 or 80 odd. If she's here, she'll probably hit me. But she gave this to me. It's called The Rose of No Man's Land. And Thel Carey was here. It was Thelma, Thel Carey. Where am I? Joy McKean was here at the show the other day. Lovely Joy McKean, Slim Dusty's wife, in case you don't know. And she said she had the music for this, and she's going to send it to me, so we might put it in the show as we tour it around Australia, folks. The Rose are coming to Kalgoorlie. Gary's a Kalgoorlie boy. Oh, God. Yeah, sure. Back to me. It's my bloody show now. You. We're sending letters to each other, so you watch it. There's a rose that grows in no man's land, and it's wonderful to see. Though it's sprayed with tears, it will live for years in the garden of memory. It's the one red rose the soldier knows, it's the work of the master's hand. Amid the war's great curse stands the Red Cross nurse. She's the rose of no man's land. Isn't that lovely? It really was difficult for me to find a song. There's not many songs written about the nurses. Just a damn shame. But what I'll do for you now is I'm going to sing this song. This was written by Jack O'Hagan, who wrote Road to Gundagai. He wrote this song way back in 1927. A lovely song. And I used to play fiddle behind the legendary Buddy Williams when he used to perform this song.
Received a letter, was a message from the war.
join the band of sisters underneath the cross of red. Despite this, every spring, red poppies bloomed, and they came to symbolise the continuation of life. In 1921, the first red poppies were brought to Australia. In 1923, the first poppy appeal was organised by returned servicemen. This tradition has continued every Remembrance Day. Rosemary has symbolised remembrance since Roman times, when it was given to friends or comrades to wear on their cloaks. So today, rosemary is worn to remember those who have died as a result of war service. Wattle must, of course, join the rosemary and the red poppy to make a uniquely Australian gesture of remembrance. Beautiful. During the First World War, loss and grief affected so many Australians, folks. In this song by Thel Carey, we feel the loss from a different perspective. Lone Kelpie, waiting by a railway station for his master to come back from the war. By a lonely railroad station, a dog sits patiently. As each train goes down the track, he watches eagerly, for the one that he is waiting for does not get off the track. When the crowds have gone their way, he drops his head again, because he doesn't know his master lay on the battlefield to die. He didn't hear the soldiers say, "Rusty survived." Now since the day he saw his master go, a figure clad in khaki is one he'd always known. But the lonely dog keeps waiting, though each long day's the same. Well, he wants to see his master's face, hear him call his name. Ooh. Rusty he'll not see again, the pal he's waiting for. The happy days together are gone forevermore. The station master sees him there and knows why he's alone. Although he can't replace his loss, he treats him as his own. But he doesn't know his master lay on the battlefield above. Didn't hear the soldiers say, the steeds were by.
Thank you.
Take us into the song.